Well, welcome all. Thank you for joining in today. You're meeting, of course, the Indian winners of the startup program of the World Expo 2020. I'm Nayantara Rai from ET Now. Thanks for tuning in. And instead of doing the boring introductions, they know the art of pitching. They must have done something right to be the winners from the World Expo 2020. So with no bias, I'll start with Siddharth on my right. You get to say your name, you get to say your startup name, and you get three sentences to inform the audience and basically pitch about what you do.
Okay. Wow. So hi, everyone. My name is Siddharth. I run a company called Kabadiwala Connect. And what we do is we integrate the informal sector into the formal waste management system to help send less waste into the landfill.
Okay, that's short and sweet. Lack.
So Lack Chinta from Atolo EdTech India Limited. So we have an award-winning technology called Talking Stickers, which helps children in listening comprehension, reading skills, and building vocabulary. And we work in 8 countries right now.
Neeraj. Hi, I'm Neeraj. I'm from Cool Crop. We build small-scale solar cold storages for farmers and farmer groups, and also provide them with predictive market analytics so that they can better know on what's the price trends going on in the markets nearby them and get most value for their produce.
Hi, everyone. This is Shreyans. I am from Sati Pets. We bring world the first biodegradable and compostable sanitary napkin that is made from banana fiber. The beauty of the product is that it biodegrades within 180 days of composting.
Okay, so now you know what they do, what their names are, and what they're doing. So let's find out a little more. Siddharth, I'll begin with you. I think your name of your startup gives it all away, right? Kabadiwala Connect, clearly looking technology and waste management. Tell us a little more, you know, how exactly does this work? He, by the way, described it as the Uber for waste management.
Well, yeah, so just to set the context, so India, we currently generate, I think, about 70 million tons of waste every year in our urban centers. And what the formal sector collects, the municipality, over 90% of that is sent to the landfill. So in this gap, you actually have this incredible network of small waste pickers, small scrap shops, large scrap shops that are really efficient in recycling and collecting material. And our primary goal is, what kind of technology can we build that integrates this supply chain? Because at the heart of this supply chain, you see these kind of networks all across the developing world. So our goal is, what we see is this incredible decentralized supply chain that now, when people are talking about marine plastic and brands are making these big commitments to plastic recycling, it's a really kind of a perfect storm to kind of look at a kind of an informal sector integration. Because at the heart of it...
Describe what you mean by the informal sector.
So informal sector is essentially, it starts with waste pickers who go out to the streets, pick up material that they think they can sell for a profit. It goes to a small scrap shop. These guys aggregate higher volumes. They sell to larger scrap shops. Informal basically means that while there's economic activity in that supply chain, it does not come under the purview of any formal system. And that's a huge problem. It permeates a lot of inequality. So waste pickers, for example, there's a World Bank study that says they get less than 5% of actually the value of the recycling material. So we come in, and one of the big solutions that we have is complete material traceability. So we're able to provide a client, either a brand or a municipality, traceability of material coming from a point of origin all the way to, let's say, a processor.
Give that with an example.
So for example, we did a project last year with Unilever, where we looked at how much volume of chips packets and multi-layer packaging can we collect from a city. And given this, can we provide waste pickers with health insurance? Can we provide health and safety kits? Okay. What is the cost, actually the cost, to do something in a sustainable way with the informal sector? So that's something that we power through our technology platform.
And of course, this is at a time when you're hearing even people like Larry Fink of BlackRock saying that you're going to see finances move towards sustainability. It is something that we're talking about. Two of the five winners that are in the world of environment. Lack, if I could come to you now, your solution, the problem that you're trying to solve has to do with education, and you're doing it with stickers. How does it work, and does it mean that he has to collect more, manage more waste?
Well, every child loves to play with stickers, so stickers are refreshing. Stickers are remarkable, rewarding for children. I used to play with stickers, I used to collect stickers. So the power, what we want to do is try to use the magic of these stickers to use technology such that these stickers can talk, sing, or read in any language, such that the children can build vocabulary, also listen to audio where children are now exposed to different languages, different contexts, understanding the reading coming out from these books. So these stickers can be affixed in any existing materials, which helps these children now to take whatever the learning is happening at home to be heard at.
Give an example, like are they learning maths, are they learning English?
So we are focusing on stories. Children love to hear stories early on. So we are focusing on children between 3 and 6 years old, because these are the children who require this kind of a technology, as well as these are the children who require stimulation. Early years are very important for children, and during these early years, the brain develops the most. And being a neuroscientist myself, we understand how the brain develops. So you need to give them with more stimulation, more words, more context, more diversified way of looking at hearing things. So that's what we work with. We work with primary school children as well in their...
Is this a subscription model, or like how does it work?
So we give them on a subscription-based model where they subscribe to our app, which also is required for the stickers to be talking in the language. So very recently, we have also moved to maternal and child health as well in terms of antenatal literacy.
Neeraj, coming to you now. I'm guessing you're primarily working with the larger farmers, the larger landowners, simply for the solution to the problem that you're finding, which is also maybe to eliminate the middleman, to have more market-driven pricing for farm produce.
On the contrary, we are our focus area is small and marginal farmers. And the problem that you're trying to address is actually their tendency to sell off the produce that they harvest, especially perishables, that is fruits and vegetables, on the same day of harvest. So when we provide them with a small scale facility to preserve their produce, to aggregate it, it kind of encourages them to not sell it off on the same day at whatever price they're getting it, and to kind of look at the market trends of the of those produce that they're cultivating and storing, and then sell it off when the prices are higher or favorable to them.
And that's worked? You've been, how do you do it, like to collect the small and marginal farmers, to convince them, and you know, if you're going to set up a storage facility, you're going to need land, are you going to need them to trust you as well?
So it's a, for example, as I said, it is a FPC, a farmer producer company or farmer producer organization that we usually work with. So these are already aggregated farmers, 500 farmers, 600 farmers, up to 1,000 farmers in some cases as well. So a storage unit, say, of size 12 feet by 8 feet by 8 feet can store around 4 to 5 metric tons of produce, which is enough for a harvest of, say, 40 to 50 farmers at once. And once they start using it, we can easily expand on that because it is a modular kind of system. So we reach out to these FPCs and FPOs, to our ground partners, and yeah, that's how we work with them over a period of 3 to 5 years.
So where all are you based at the moment? Where all do you have these storage facilities?
So we now have 16 installations across 6 states in India, Gujarat, Karnataka, West Bengal, Bihar, Telangana, and Odisha.
Okay. Shreyans, if I could come to you now. They say a sanitary napkin takes more than 500 to 600 years. To fully decompose, which basically means the first ever sanitary napkin ever worn on this planet still has not decomposed. That's the solution you're trying to find. I know a lot of brands are claiming that they are 100% biodegradable, but they're not. Is yours?
Yes, it is. So I would like to like give a good background to this. We live at a time where every second in India, 400 sanitary napkins are being disposed of. And most of these sanitary napkins, as you rightly pointed out, take around 500 to 600 years to biodegrade. The problem, another problem with these sanitary napkins are, because they are plastic-based, they're chemical-based, they are not only harmful to the environment, but to the users as well, right? So what we have done essentially is, we have replaced the core material, that is SAP, the gel, the core absorbent, with banana fiber. And we have covered the top layer and bottom layer with plant-based materials. Essentially, the end product, it does not have any chemicals, it does not have any sap, it does not have any plastic. It's 100% biodegradable. Once disposed of, it biodegrades within 180 days. And the product is not only biodegradable, it is compostable as well.
are women taking to them? What has been the market reaction?
So it has been like 3-4 years now that we have launched it commercially. There have been three kinds of users that have taken the product up. One that are sensitive, their skin are sensitive, they want a product that is good for them, that does not harm them. The second ones are the ones that want an eco-friendly product, right? The product that does not harm them. They don't want to leave a footprint out of their existence. So that is the second set of users that we have targeted. And third is under the Sathi model, what we have done is we like every pet that a woman buy in urban area, we use the income to subsidize the pets that we sell in rural areas, right? So there is a third set of users who are attracted by this model. Okay. They appreciate it and they want to buy Sathi pets for it. So the market reactions has been very good, not only in India, throughout the world.
Okay. So now we know a little more about the startups. And a quick reminder, if you guys want to come in on the conversation, raise your hands. I'll come to you. What I found very interesting about all your stories as well is that you're all, of course, solving problems and finding solutions for India, but these can be globally scaled up as well. And so coming to you first, Siddharth, do you think that's something that worked for you at the World Expo 2020, where the jury and the entire process that you had to go through could relate to it and say that, hey, this is something that India can take to the world or it can be expanded and grown? Because you're all bootstrapped as well.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, it's been a fascinating experience being one of the global innovators as part of Expo 2020 in Dubai. It really is a platform that's kind of, for me at least, when I first started, you know, you don't think of these kind of big platforms. And the philosophy for us was very much a decentralized model. So as people really care about, it's not waste anymore, but rather it's a resource that has kind of finished one part of its life and then can be used for something else, whatever material it is, wet waste, plastic. So for us, what we were really talking about was a decentralized model of collection. And that was something that, especially with the expo, you know, people are grappling with this issue globally, because we have a waste problem. We're, you know, especially richer countries are very used to sending their stuff somewhere else. China stopped taking it in, which created this huge kind of crisis in the ecosystem. So for us, the idea of decentralization as a core element of efficiency was something very valuable, and the Expo 2020 is kind of an amazing platform for us. And yeah, definitely there's a lot of validation on that model for us. Yeah.
Have you been chased since the Expo 2020 by investors?
Well, unfortunately, we're a very B2B, unsexy.
Are you trying to tell me that B2B guys don't get chased by investors? Because that's not
true. Well, yeah, no. So being chased by clients and investors is one thing, but being chased by other people and as from a purely communication perspective is very different.
What are you going to do with what you won?
So we won $100,000. Actually, all of us.
All of you did.
All of us won $100,000. What we did was we built a hyperlocal collection service where we wanted to prove that with the small scrap shop and the waste picker, they can handle last mile collection of waste from households. And we've been running that project for 1.5 years. Through this project, we're collecting about 1 ton of plastic from 30 apartments every week. And it was an amazing proof of concept to take to investors and clients and say, look, you can scale this. You can basically think of cities removing this need for last mile collection. You don't need this big transfer station or diesel trucks coming in, but rather guys on tricycles picking it up and then creating a much more efficient reverse logistics chain.
Lack, coming to you, did you find that it was easier to impress the jury at the Expo 2020, because kids on this planet, around the world, irrespective of whichever country they are in, will want to, you know, their parents will want to use something like this?
So definitely, I think Expo's due diligence was very, we had 3 rounds of due diligence to get into the Expo 2020. And I think all the 5 Indian winners at the Expo did a great job in convincing the jury to put their weight behind the investment here.
And because, you know, they say baby businesses, kid businesses are usually booming businesses, whether it's a recession or not. Parents want to continue spending on their kids, right? So you must have had a lot of competition too.
Yes, there were 6,000 applications from 120 countries. It's a very competitive program, Expo Life. They want to see real innovations which have a grassroots impact to the world. For us personally, what Expo Live did is the project was allocated for India. We tested three use cases. One of the most innovative use cases we tried out of National Institute for Speech and Hearing in Thiruvananthapuram was looking at how talking stickers can help deaf children through sign language, because deaf children have delayed language acquisition because they're diagnosed, and for the first time their parents need to also be learning sign language. So it's an experience for them too. So this was something where the talking stickers could be used at home for children to learn the sign language with their parents.
Are you looking at other disabilities too?
Yes, we looked at autism as well. We looked at attention ADHDs. We also looked at rural sector. A lot of these things through the expo, we were able to take it to Central Asia, for example, where we did a pilot project for one academic year in Tajikistan with Aga Khan Foundation, a big foundation which put the weight behind us. And also it got us ready to be commercially ready and try out different business models. I think that was the key for us through the expo, that now we are selling in private schools.
Neeraj, coming to you, how did you convince the jury? Like, do you think there was a turning moment, or share experience with us?
In terms of expo or
expo
personal journey? Expo. I think the Expo Live program is impact focused. So they want to see what impact, economic and social impact, our innovations make to our customers or users of the technologies. So if you look at the scale of impact in India itself, about 80% or more farmers are small and marginal farmers. A report in 2017, I think, pegged the food wastage at across, like, especially for fruits and vegetables, at around 95,000 crore. And though we have infrastructure at distribution end, but at supply side, where farmers usually harvest and aggregate, there's a lack of it. So I think that's what kind of convinced them that there is
a. What are you going to do with the prize money?
We already had one cycle coming through, and we used it for the development of the control that we have for the cold storage, as well as the app, the analytics app that we have. And of course, to kind of run the operations of the company, and yeah.
Shans, I'm going to come to you. I want to ask you one question. Please don't take it in the wrong way. Do you have any of your founders females, and are any of your senior executives in the startup females? And is that a challenge? Just because of what you do. Don't take it in the wrong way.
Yeah, no worries. So out of four founders, three of them are female.
Okay.
We have a factory that is run entirely by women. Yeah. 75% of our office is run by women. So I think that should...
So you're a minority.
Yeah, we are a minority.
Okay.
So in fact, that has enabled us to understand the product, right? Because being users, they can connect with it. They can feel the pain points that come with the product,
yeah.
Right? So, that has helped us a lot in convincing people about the product. If it has been through only a male co-founder, it would have been very difficult, right? Having so many women behind the project, behind the movement, it helps us a lot.
Okay, and so tell me something. I believe you have a Robin Hood model as well, right? Do you want to elaborate a bit on that? Because, and is that sustainable? Is that something you guys are committed to as well? Because, you know, it does start out like this year. You know, startups begin with a vision.
Of course, yeah.
And then, you know, when you're growing, of course your vision has to keep changing, but then you forget a lot of the values you stood for, right?
True, that does happen. But, the word you have, in fact, pointed out is right, sustainable, right? We wanted to build a model that is sustainable, that comes into the concept of circular economy, right? So, it's very difficult, to be very honest. But yes, we have kept our focus over there. In the Robin Hood model, what I have essentially, in fact, said earlier is, we take money that is earned from urban sales and use it to subsidize our rural sales. Right, so that we provide pads at a rate which is very affordable to them.
So give an example, how much do you sell it for in the urban areas and how much do you sell it for in rural? parts?
So in urban areas, our pads would range from a pad of say 8 box or 12 box. It would come for 180 rupees to 360 rupees.
So you're far more expensive than, let's say, the Unilevers. You were talking about Unilever.
We are competing in the organic space. So, but like if you
and
compare
in the rural, how much is it?
In the rural, it can range from free distribution. Right, there are certain sectors which cannot afford it. They simply don't have the capacity. So for instance, we run a program called 1 million pads in Jharkhand, wherein we have distributed pads like that, right? Because they just can't afford it. We educate them on this so that they don't take it as a free commodity and misuse it. But so we have distributed for free. Then we have distributed pads for say 5 rupees, 7 rupees, up to 8 rupees as well.
Okay, with that, we've run out of time. Are there any questions? Go ahead.
So I would like to know about how you do you even train the rural segment for your product, because I have worked in an NGO that deals with menstrual hygiene, and what I found in my initial research was that the awareness about the original product, that I would say the like Unilever product, is even low. They do not want to use it. They still prefer the kapda. So I would like you to elaborate about how do you train those people to actually and make them adopt to a product like this.
That is a very like huge pain point when it comes to training women in rural areas. It's very difficult, and they don't want to talk about it. It's a myth. It's a taboo concept, right? And the reason they are using cloth pads is because one, they don't have a facility, right? And so we go by step one. We make it available, right? So it's available. You have an alternative now. Till now, you didn't have an alternative, so that was a challenge, right? So step one is there. Second, we enroll in local sevikas. We call them sevikas, local women who have an influence on the community, right? And who have the aptitude to understand the importance of it and everything. They help us bring in the change. So they help us, conduct workshops with the local women. They mobilize them, and they are our key standpoints who help us communicate the message. So these key influencers in the village, they have been our player for this particular movement.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Louise from the Netherlands Embassy here in India. We work a lot with Dutch startups coming to India, but also the other way around. I first wanted to congratulate you on getting into the expo. So I hope you also visit the Dutch pavilion. We're focusing on the nexus of water, energy, and food. So I definitely think for some of you that might be really interesting. My question is, how do you guys think you're going to differentiate yourself at the expo? There will also be a lot of other international startups walking around. So how is the India team going to stand up for the Indian innovation?
Yeah, I think just by the scale of it and the sort of problems we have in India and sort of problems that we are solving here, not just these startups, but also many other startups that are into like social enterprise space in India, I don't think you would find those kind of problems and solutions for other countries. So if we have that kind of showcase where we see grassroots innovation coming out to solve problems which are specific, very specific, and still very kind of have a global context. For example, a farmer, small farmer in India, like not even cutting off his produce, harvesting his produce, just because he's not getting the right price, letting it all rot on the field. Has a global kind of repercussion in terms of the $1 billion being wasted as food waste. So I think that context of India being at a place in time where it has problems which are very different from what other countries may have, and solutions which are coming up from grassroots, from within the local context, which we have to offer.
Okay, so with that, I think we'll call an end to this panel discussion. Thanks so much for being here. I'm sure they're still going to hang around if any of you want to approach them. And congratulations to all of you once again.